Welcome to the Oshkosh Advisory Parks Board meeting, August 13th. Please make sure all cell phones are silenced, do not disturb anything during the meeting. And let's just go right into roll call.
Davis?
Here.
Barrett?
Here.
Riddle?
Here.
Herman?
Here.
Hudak? Kaufman?
Here.
Miller?
Here.
Lester?
Here.
I'm sorry, Millet?
Yep. Either or, I'm here both ways.
All right, election of officers.
All right, I will take the floor. I will open up nominations for the chair for the next year.
I nominate Amy Davis.
Any other nominations for the chair? Last call for nominations for the chair? Seeing none, Bill, would you like to make a recommendation, a unanimous vote for Amy?
Sure.
Second by anybody?
I'll second it.
You can take call.
Davis?
I vote for myself, sure.
Dirk?
Aye.
Riddle?
Aye.
Herman?
Aye.
Kaufman?
Aye.
Miller?
Aye.
Millet?
Aye.
Motion passed 7-0.
All right, I can do vice chair. Any nominations for vice chair?
I nominate Tony.
I don't have to second it, do I? Can I second it? I second it. Any other nominations? All right, I make a recommendation for Tony as vice chair. Or does Bill? Bill has to?
Bill made the motion.
Oh.
You're okay. You made the second.
Davis?
Aye.
Tony, do you want to vote for yourself?
Sure.
Royal?
Aye.
Herman?
Aye.
Hudak? Kaufman?
Aye.
Miller?
Aye.
Millet?
Aye.
Motion passed 7-0.
Will that spike go in there?
All right, any comments, questions about the July 9th minutes?
I'll make a motion to accept the minutes as mailed out.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, are there any citizens? Any citizen statements not on the agenda? All right, new business. Hey, let's talk about map for Lakeshore.
Thank you. What we have on the agenda for tonight, I'm going to actually have Kelly Nyforth, who's with the Economic Development Services. She's the manager for that department or that division. And then James Robbie, who is our director of Public Works. It's really been their two departments working closely on a number of these items out at the Lakeshore site. The first one is going to be an explanation of the certified survey map that you received in your packet. Kelly will go through some information on the road locations, why they're in their certain locations. And then there's some talk that we'll have about some land swap, land disposition on the southern portion of the Lakeshore site. And she'll get into some of the reasons why that is being recommended. It's been discussed by the Common Council as far as the future of Oshkosh Avenue coming in through that area. And there are plans to down the road widen that and do some other enhancements potentially. So there's a need for additional right-of-way on the front side of these businesses and to help accommodate and not to have any fiscal impact. Kelly will explain a land swap that the city is looking at with some of the private businesses along that section. And then James Robbie will talk a little bit about some of the stormwater management and the preliminary design as far as those items go. So I'm going to turn it over to Kelly and she'll kick it off. And
sure. We can do that.
Thank you very much, everybody, for having us here today. I can give a little background on what you're looking at. We have, as I have mentioned in the memo, as part of the Oshkosh Corporation proposal to them, we had said we would dedicate right-of-way to their site so they knew that they had access to the parcel showing up on the screen, the lot 2. With that, we had to do that pretty early on in the process. We did it before we were able to do a lot of due diligence that typically we do for construction projects, road construction projects. So it was done to make sure that the Oshkosh Corporation had access to their site, and then also at the same time, we were submitting for grants to help assist with funding for these projects, and we had to have something in place for that. So we had put together a CSM this past fall, and then earlier this, in early 2018, we had dedicated right away for the North Keller extension. And with that, in the past 3-4 months, we've done a lot of due diligence on site, gathered a lot of information, met with a lot of different agencies within the state to discuss what would be the best layout for that North Keller extension. And I think I'll probably pass it over to James so he can kind of discuss some of the reasons why we're looking at this change today.
Yeah, thanks, Kelly. Once we got out there and were able to work on wetland delineations in particular, the original layout was impacting more wetlands, would have required an additional significant level of permitting. Army Corps, you know, it basically come out and said, you really want to avoid this level of permitting, otherwise we have to go through a process that's going to take you over a year to get through before you can get your permit. So we looked at doing some alternative layouts and modifying the streets a little bit to get under a threshold to stay in a general permitting situation with both the Army Corps and the DNR. So we did a lot of modifications. At one point, the assured wetland delineator that the city had used, the assured wetland delineator that the developer had used, and a third assured wetland delineator met on site with Army Corps and DNR staff, and so they all got together and started kind of tweaking where the boundary lines were and coming up with, you know, kind of shrinking them a little bit so that we could get some of the street layouts in and reduce those impacts so we could stay in a general permit situation.
Right, so with those considerations that we, you know, took when designing the road, you will see that there was some, I guess you could call it just some excess land in between the proposed road and then where the private property is that fronts onto Oshkosh Ave. It's approximately that kind of excess area. It's just under 50,000 square feet of land that would be landlocked between the road and a private property. So at the same time, we were looking at extending North Westfield, and there is a private developer that currently is working on redeveloping the area on Oshkosh Ave, and we needed him to dedicate right-of-way for North Westfield to be extended through. So at the same time, we also asked him to dedicate some of his frontage on Oshkosh Ave. So in the future, for City Council's direction, we could extend Oshkosh Ave and widen it if we needed to. So with that, Mr. Hoopman, he had dedicated, I have the totals here in the memo, he'll have dedicated just around 35,000 square feet. And on the CSM here, we're proposing on Outlot 1 that we, since he gave the city just over 35,000 square feet of land for our right-of-way, we're proposing that we dispose of 36,184 square feet of that Outlet 1, which matches up with kind of his property lines from where he has control for that private property there, in order to kind of call it a land swap. So city is able to get the right-of-way we need to serve the new developments in that area, and at the same time, he has land that he can still develop on in the north, and there's no, you know, the city doesn't need to pay for that. So that's why we're here today, is to look at disposing that landlocked area. And Outlet 2, there's just over 13,000 square feet left. At this time, we didn't feel it was right to swap or, you know, dispose of that to him, so we're holding on to that until, you know, in the future there might be another developer that might come forward, but in the meantime we're just holding on to that.
Yeah, the results of the traffic impact analysis that were performed for the area did indicate a need to develop turn lanes on Oshkosh Avenue in order to continue to provide an acceptable level of service on Oshkosh Avenue. So in order to develop those turn lanes is why we needed to get that additional right-of-way from the developer, you know, so we could, you know, get the traffic movement in and out, and there just wasn't enough right-of-way existing in Oshkosh Ave to be able to do that.
I guess as far as the CSM goes and the land disposal, that's, unless anybody else has any questions, I don't know if we want to start talking about stormwater right away, if anybody has any questions about the disposal.
I think let's address the land disposition, just because that requires action from the board, because it will go to the Plan Commission. Mm-hmm. And then James is here more of an informational at this point to give you an idea what we're looking at for stormwater.
Yeah. Again, back, not getting into stormwater, but I mean, is the developer 100% happy with this arrangement? We're not strong-arming him at all or anything? Okay.
We've been pretty upfront with him. He knows that we need the right-of-way. He understands that. And, you know, we've said, well, there is some landlocked, you know, land here that it might make sense, and it does work for his development, too, that he can still develop on site.
And maybe this will help you build. James, are we still on track of not allowing any in and out on Oshkosh Ave to any of these businesses? They actually will be accessing the property from behind, in a sense, right?
Correct. All ingress and egress from the developments along Oshkosh Avenue will be either from Westfield or Keller Street. There will be no driveways onto Oshkosh Avenue.
So that way they got more room towards the, if you can think of it, the backside, mm-hmm, of the property versus, mm-hmm, the Oshkosh Ave side. So I know that gets confusing for some people that...
Yeah, and I mean, if this developer just gave us the stuff right, you know, right out of the gate, I just want to make sure we're not putting a gun to his head, you know, on the back end of the deal or anything like that.
as Kelly said, this is something that we had discussed with him right from the start.
Okay.
You know, as soon as we started working on this, you know, even before we had the traffic impact analysis done, we knew we would need turn lanes of some kind to be able to facilitate their development. At the time, we thought it would be right turn lanes from, like, westbound Oshkosh Ave. We thought it would need right turn lanes to get into the development on the north side. The way the analysis actually turns out, instead of having dedicated right turn lanes, there's actually developing a dedicated left turn lane for westbound to southbound, so you get that traffic out of the free flow of westbound traffic. You know, anybody who drives through that area, you know, during peak times knows you stay in the right lane because you're going to get stuck by somebody trying to turn south on Westfield.
Right.
So developing that left turn lane keeps two through lanes moving much more freely.
Great. I really believe that this is going to end up being a new gateway into the city, you know, because we've never punched 20th Ave through, to my dismay, but it just never happened. So I think that this is going to be just another new gateway into the city. So I'm, as long as everybody's happy, I'm thrilled with this.
Well, maybe just question to Ray. It doesn't affect, from the diagramming of what we have for the dedicated park, it doesn't really have any effect to the park, really.
No, as you're aware, Steve, throughout all the discussions, we had imagine that there would be some type of roadway going through there.
Right.
And I think working with James and Kelly and all the different entities involved, the big thing was we had to avoid some of those wetland pockets. And by doing the roadway and the current alignment, I think makes sense and really minimally impacts the parkland as far as what we were showing early on in the process. Any other questions on the CSM at all? Otherwise, James, if you want to kind of jump to your diagram and just talk about some of the stormwater management we've had discussions on as well.
Yeah, up on screen is, you know, kind of a map showing, you know, where we're at as far as developing a water quality basin on site, and then you know, to kind of mitigate some of the loss of green space there, we're actually going to be filling in two of the existing landscape/irrigation ponds. As far as open water area goes, we'll be filling about 1.1 acres and creating about 0.9 acres. So there'll be a net reduction in open water of about 0.2 acres on the site. There will be a storm sewer running through from the Keller Street extension all the way out to Lake Butamore. you know, but that's just, you know, an underground utility pipe, you know, not creating any open surface water area to, you know, impact use of the parkland. So, you know, we were looking at, also, as we were looking at it, we kind of moved it over right up against the boundary line between the Oshkosh Corporation site and the rest of the park. Again, to try to minimize the overall impact to the rest of the parking and keep as much open space, you know, kind of together instead of breaking it up as we could. So we were kind of strategically locating it in that area to try to minimize the impacts as much as we could.
What is this going to look like, James, towards, I envision an opportunity to make this look something like South Park a little bit. I mean, is that our end goal here? That this isn't just one of our typical retention ponds where we kind of fence it off and forget about it?
No, we haven't gotten into the full design yet, but that's been our intent as well as, we'll take a look at how South Park's coming along with the shoreline. And James, you can speak to some of this too, because you've got other ponds that you deal with, but we have talked about more of the native plantings and not strictly mowing right up to the edges as far as that goes as well. And I know John Ferris has been working on some other planting ideas for the shoreline and potential hillside around there as well.
Yeah, any, you know, one, you know, we don't fence any of the detention basins. You know, we generally go with a more native vegetation. They're a little bit lower maintenance, a lot of maintenance early on to try to get the natives established. In some cases, you know, we're some of the basins we may have, you know, lost a little bit to the invasives. You know, we're going through a process right now to really try and take that over and get that back to what we wanted it to look like. In this particular case, you know, as Ray mentioned, we haven't worked out the final design of the vegetation maintenance of it and what vegetation is going to be installed. But the process of actually vegetating those natives, it's going to be about a 2 or 3 year process. So, you know, depending, you know, if that gets, you know, constructed yet this fall or next spring, you know, it's probably about 2 years out before we're actually going to be planting the natives in there, you know, going through a process of killing off the invasive seed bank that exists in the topsoil. You know, so that gives us some time yet to figure out exactly what we want it to look like.
I just see an opportunity here with this park, and I want to make sure we're starting off on a footing. I mean, I think we can turn this into a real jewel here. So, and what I meant by fencing off is I think right there, that retention pond is fenced off right there at Oshkosh Ave and Kohler. I mean, that one is.
The DOT one? No, I don't think that one is.
Isn't it? I thought it was.
I don't think that DOT one is there. I may be mistaken.
I could be too.
I don't pay that close of attention when I drive through it.
Sure.
Or drive around it, I should say.
But that's not a city pond, though.
Right.
No, that.
But I just.
To Bill's comment, would there be potentially any possibility of fishing in this pond? Like the county park has two of their ponds, they do allow. In their stormwater ponds, they do allow fishing. It's catch and release, but where this is going to outflow to the lake, just, you know, possibility of a fishing pier going in there or something that it would enhance the park experience. Because if you go along that shoreline, and I know we're going to be building a river walk along there, that this area in there is pretty swampy, marshy, mucky. You're not going to get much fishing in there. So I'm just kind of curious if there's any preliminary discussion that we could do something with a fishing pier or something in this.
We're not trying to put pressure on you, James. We just want to make it clear that, you know, we all, this board really envisions this as being, you know, first-class park.
Right, and from my standpoint, you know, rather than trying to do something with fishing, I would go more towards the look, the aesthetics of it, informational, educational materials around it. The Department of Natural Resources does have some prohibitions against, I believe it's called fish rearing or fish raising in stormwater ponds.
Okay.
You know, and, you know, so there's, you know, certainly would have to use some caution there. South Park, a little bit of a different animal in that, you know, the department has historically stocked that every spring for the fishing events, and the department has indicated they're going to continue to do so. And in fact, with the improvements that have been made in the South Park system, they're actually thinking of stocking some additional species in that one. So, you know, I think that one continues to be a little bit of a unique situation. you know, at this point, we hadn't planned anything from a fishing standpoint.
No, I just thrown it out there.
Yeah.
You know, I think there's some good opportunities to, you know, as you said, Bill, make it look good and, you know, be able to provide, you know, some additional information and educational materials. You know, that's one of the things at South Park, too. We do have planned a lot of informational signage going up around it. So as you kind of walk the trail around South Park, there'll be a series of informational signage, you know, stormwater related, park related. You know, we haven't worked out all the details of what those are going to say. You know, but I don't know if you've seen, you know, we do have some informational signage up at some of the other city detention basins. I know the one out by Pick and Save North, there's some informational signage.
Murdoch Street, Murdoch.
Yeah. Tipler, yeah. Baldwin by New York. Yeah. Actually, the Melvin Avenue pump station even has a sign out in front of it. So, you know, I'd look at kind of expanding that around here as well to, you know, kind of roll in with the look of it.
One last thought, have we run this by motor truck and they're okay with this and everything too? I mean,
as far as the design and the location,
yeah,
we've been having
okay.
very regular meetings with their design
okay.
team and
Perfect.
Their construction manager.
Yes.
At least weekly conference calls, if not
yep.
more often
Absolutely.
With
okay.
them. So.
All right. And they're okay with this as is too?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, our first design had been a little bit smaller, again, trying to reduce the impacts. They had some concerns over how it was impacting their system on site. So we took a closer look at the modeling of it and, you know, kind of shoehorned it up into that corner a little bit more and made it just a little bit bigger to address the concerns that their design team had.
Perfect. That's all I got, so.
Any other questions?
Not, we should get a recommendation to approve the CSM because the Plan Commission and Council will need to act on it as well.
I recommend the CSM as
second.
Well. Davis?
Aye.
Dirk?
Aye.
Royal?
Aye.
Herman?
Aye.
Kubak? Kaufman?
Aye.
Miller?
Aye.
Millett?
Aye.
Just real quickly, as long as we're on this item, we recently had conversations with all the departments involved. Originally, we had thought about possibly opening up the Lakeshore site again, because as you're aware, we have a temporary close sign on the park. But with James and this project beginning within the next 60 to 90 days, potentially, instead of confusing people, opening up the property for a while and then putting signs back up, we've decided that we're going to keep it closed because there will be excavation on both the east and west sides of the Oshkosh Corp site. So if you had any questions, we're going to wait until this construction is done, or at least till the stormwater portion is done. So.
All right, any old business?
Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good seeing you.
All right, staff reports.
What I will do is I'm going to just give you a couple of reports on some of the projects we're working on, and then as you sat down this evening, you should see what we're calling our 2017 impact report. Essentially, it's our annual report for 2017, coming a little late, but it's portion of my fault because I've been busy with other things. But Ann Schaefer, who is our marketing and fund developer, really worked closely with our division managers to come up with this information from 2017. And once we go through and do our reports, I'll have the staff members that were a part of this talk about their areas and just let you and the public know what took place in 2017. We've done a pretty good job, I think, as far as letting you know on current project going on. Just giving you a recap of what last year entailed. As far as projects that I'm currently working on, the Spanbauer Field project, the renovation, is currently out for bids. Those will be coming in within the next 2 weeks, and expect that an award will be going to the Common Council at their first meeting in September. So we would begin that project yet here in September, with hopefully getting things completed before the snow flies. The other project that we're going to be getting bids out here very quickly is behind the Leach Amphitheater, the Riverwalk rehab. There's some sections of the Riverwalk that have essentially sunk down behind the seawall and become a trip hazard. So we're currently working on designs and getting that out to bid. Our hope is that that will go to the Common Council as well for award in early September, and we'll be working on that project this fall as well. As part of Common Council's recent approval of some Healthy Neighborhood Initiative funding, Stegbauer Park, the play equipment there, we've been working with the Neighborhood Association. That's one project that they have applied for some grant funding through the city to replace that play equipment. I have met with some of the representatives from the Neighborhood Association. They were hoping to complete the project this fall, but they'd like to do some fundraising to supplement what the city is putting towards the project to upgrade some benches and a few other items in the park. So they've decided to wait and have this as a spring project. So when the CIP is approved in November, we may have some additional playgrounds that will be replaced and renovated next year, so we'll bid these out in a package depending on how many are approved in our CIP. South Park, if you've gone by recently, you've seen that it's taken a lot better shape over the last month or so. We have a final punch list walkthrough to do tomorrow morning, and I believe the fence will be coming down probably in the next week or two. The turf really has come up. I think they hit a good growing cycle when they got it down with the hydro mulch and the hydro seed. It's coming up fairly well, but we are going to be asking citizens when we do remove the fence to please stay on the asphalt paths as much as possible to help us get the turf established. So that is finalizing, and as well as the work around the parking lot. Other item that we've been all very busy on is our budget. Our 2019 budget submissions are due this Friday, so we've been working on all our division budgets, as well as performance evaluations, which are due by the end of the month. And I believe you saw an email come through, but the Riverwalk grand opening of the section by the Morgan District is going to be Thursday, August 23rd, and that will be at 4 o'clock. You'll be able to park, come off of 6th Street, along the gravel driveway, along the fence where all the Oshkosh Corp trucks used to be parked in that area. There's a gravel driveway that comes back to the site. So we will be having a grand opening there for that section of the Riverwalk. We also, the guys worked on getting the Lakefly art pieces installed that were constructed by local artists. And then there was a Lakefly event at the Unity in the Community earlier this year. Our staff got those installed along various sections of the Riverwalk, both on the north and south side of the Riverwalk, as well as one down at the Opera House Square. So I know that the community's been out taking a look at those. Unfortunately, over the weekend, we did have one of those vandalized already, the one that's placed on the Morgan District site. So we're asking citizens to please keep your eyes out. And obviously, there's been a lot of time and effort and money put into these pieces of public art. And if you see anybody tampering with them or damaging them, to please call the police department, because, again, it's supposed to be something that people can enjoy for a nice long time and tour the city. And unfortunately, over the weekend, somebody did vandalize one of those. As far as the impact report goes, I'm not going to read word for word, because I think it'd be a lot more beneficial for our staff to talk about what they accomplished in 2017. But just to give you an idea, under the mission statement of our department, you'll take a look at what our department is all responsible for. Parks, facilities, parks and urban forestry programs, Riverside Cemetery, Menominee Park Zoo, Pollock Community Water Park, Leach Amphitheater, Children's Amusement Center, and the Senior Center was also put under our department back in 2012. So definitely a lot to keep us busy. Some of the highlights that I can touch on for the Senior Center, because obviously they don't come to this board and report to us, to you directly, but if you take a look at page 4, last year was the first year that we offered the AnyFin as Possible. This is for special needs students from the school district that typically had a fishing day over at Menominee Park in the early spring, and they found that it wasn't as accessible, or they didn't have a facility if the weather wasn't cooperating. So having the Senior Center available and having the fishing pier and a boat launch right by the senior center. We offered up that site, and they love it. They came back in May of this year again for another event, and it I think it's going to continue to be an annual event at the facility. Some great donors and sponsors. You can take a look at those. The Oshkosh Boat Club brings a couple of their boats down, and the kids get to drive or ride up, not drive, but ride up and down the river system. They get tours on boats. They take them up to the Butamore Bridge and get to see underneath the Butamore Bridge. And kids are fishing off the pier, and this year we caught a number of fish, which is pretty neat because when they're at Menominee Park, it was difficult for them to catch fish as well, so they're happy to catch some fish. So again, Oshkosh Boat Club, Sweetwater Performance Center, Otter Street Fishing Club actually donates a fishing pole for each of the participants that day, so we want to thank them. The Winnebago Lakes Council, Fox River Brewing Company, Blue Moose Stores, and volunteers from the community just coming out and driving boats and helping out. Next item, the Seasand Sailorland Playground Equipment. That project was completed last fall. Some of the restoration was just completed this spring with the turf reestablishing. That was a project, again, with the Neighborhood Association, the Menominee South Neighborhood Association, that we work closely with the Community Foundation on some fundraising efforts, as well as the Neighborhood Association to provide input on the design. Food trucks, as everybody knows, food trucks have really become a hit. The Senior Center, the Friends of the Senior Center, which is their official fundraising group, started these down at South Park last year, and they continue this year. They do one each month, June, July, and August. Last year, approximately 2,000 people attended each of those events. And I know this year, the first one was, I believe they said there was over 3,000 people at that one. So they do have their final one coming up actually this Friday, the 17th. So if you're out and about, it's a great great community event out at South Park, live music, food, and enjoyment. Jenny, you want to talk about some of your items and skip around if you want, as long as I'm turning it over to you.
Okay. So, like we mentioned about the food trucks, so our Tuesday night concert series, tomorrow night is the last one of those. It's been very, very successful this year. We, Verve Credit Union, is still the main sponsor for that event. And this year, actually, WPS was the family entertainment sponsor as well, so we were able to offer more family activities. And I know I was just working on some budgets to some numbers today for budgets. And at this time last year, we were around 3,000 people that had been through the five concert series, and right now we're at about 5,000. So we're up 2,000 total people from last year. Tomorrow night, if no one's busy, we have the Presidents tomorrow night, which they put on a great show. It should be a great night. It'll be our last one of the six-week concert series. So I'm sure we'll see a good crowd tomorrow night for that last one, and with the Presidents there. So it's been great this year. We've had food trucks down there, face painting every week, bounce houses, other entertainment like balloons. We had a bubble night. Tomorrow night we're actually having the Oshkosh Rhythm and Rhyme Institute down there doing drum circles with the kids, just kind of all different kinds of things for young and old. So we see families come in kind of earlier to eat dinner, play, bounce around, and then as the concert starts, other people come in to watch the music. So it's been really, really good this year and growing, and we hope to have that growing every year. So you want me to keep going? Okay, so this will be mostly my report that I just wrote down. So on page 8, our facilities, the different facilities we have some really, really great sponsors. All of our events that we have are sponsored by people throughout the community. This year again at Pollock Pool, we had Winnebago Community Credit Union is our sponsor for all of our special events there. And we had all new special events this year, which were a lot of fun. It's been a really good year for them, really hot summer, so our numbers there are definitely up quite a bit, so we'll be interested to see where that's at. We've got about a week and a half left and the pool closes for the season, so it feels like it's come really quick already, but it'll definitely be a good year there as far as attendance and concessions and admissions. The amphitheater also, we hosted the Kids from Wisconsin this year, which was a great event that was sponsored by the Oshkosh Community Foundation for a grant that we applied for through them. So that was, again, a great event. Julie's Touch of Silver performed as well that day. They opened for the Kids from Wisconsin, and both of those, both groups draw a lot of people. Julie's Touch of Silver is a great studio, and lots of families come down to support the girls. And then the Kids from Wisconsin are really awesome as well. We also did 4 movie nights at the Leach Amphitheater this summer, and those all were sponsored by different community members as well. So all the movie nights are free, and we have the bounce houses, we have face painting, and just a good, it's free for families to come down and eat. And those nights for movies, we kind of just do light concessions down there. So what else do we have here?
Just wanted to touch on a number real quick on top of page 8 with Jenny and the attendance figures that they keep at all of the facilities. Menominee Park Zoo, Pollock Community Water Park, Leach Amphitheater, and the Amusement Center attracts over 190,000 visitors annually. So you take a look at just some of the numbers of groups and children that come out to these venues that we have. It's really great to see. And a lot of the events that Jenny has obviously promotes a lot of those numbers as well. So
that's it for me in here. So
okay, I'll jump in with the Landscape Operations Division areas. Last year, we, in cooperation with Community Development and the Planning Division, developed a proposal for a DNR grant, and we were successful in gaining $25,000. And with that, those grant dollars, we conducted 4 different tree planting workshops and tree care workshops, primarily directed toward the neighborhood association groups. So we had 4 workshops conducted by several different certified arborists. They were very well attended. We had, through that project, also planted over 300 trees, primarily up in the North Park Neighborhood Association area, which was a kind of a more recently developed area that didn't have a lot of trees planted. So we were able to fill in parts of that neighborhood. And then as also part of that grant, we were able to inject an additional 570 ash trees for protection against emerald ash borer. So that was throughout various different neighborhoods that we were working on that part of the project. So all in all, we had a kind of a very comprehensive project and rated fairly well. Also, as kind of an offshoot of this project, we've gained some other dollars coming forward into similar projects that will occur this fall through a Great Lakes Planning Association grant. So another project that we were very actively involved with last year was working with the Oshkosh for Education project called Curb Appeal. And what we did is primarily a lot of the design work and the logistical work in association with re-landscaping all of the public schools with the assistance of a variety of volunteers from the schools and the neighborhoods. So this was a very huge undertaking. And the idea was to upgrade the looks of a lot of these public properties to entice people to move into the neighborhoods, to care better for the school landscapes as well. So we had, just a tremendous volunteer effort and also financial contributions that went through the Community Foundation to help that effort in not only landscaping, but also upgrades to play equipment and some of the site amenities that are present on a lot of the school properties. Another project in my area that was completed last year was we were able to gain some grant funding to restore the interior of the Riverside Chapel at Riverside Cemetery. And that's a property that's on the National Registry of Historic Places. So having done a lot of the exterior work over the last decade or so, we wanted to repair some of the plaster and do interior painting in that structure. So that was all completed. And then as part of our promotional efforts at Riverside Cemetery, we've been conducting historic tours, and we have some tours coming up this fall. I believe it's in October that will be conducted out on the grounds. As a starting point for a lot of the tours, they begin in the Riverside Chapel, so people are able to take a look at that improvement, as well as get a tour with our throughout the property to see a lot of the history of Oshkosh. So it's been kind of a cool project. We're hoping to get more people out on site to take advantage of the asset that sometimes gets ignored as people pass by in their busy lives. So look forward to more tours here coming up in the future, as I mentioned, and we'll do it again in the spring as well. So I don't think I'll go through all the division overview items. I think everyone is pretty much aware of what our landscape division works on. We've been doing a lot of maintenance this summer and a lot of planting bed areas, you know, trying to keep everything upgraded. We've did a complete inventory of all the areas that we've currently maintained, and it's kind of incredible how many little spots that are under our responsibility aside from maintaining all the trees in the city too, so.
Good, Bill. I think this is when you read through this, for me, I think about how fast a year goes and where it goes. It's hard to catch up with, but I think it's pretty impressive to see everything come together, especially one thing in Jenny's area with events. When you think of in Bill's areas and other spots for memorial benches and all that stuff, of how much community support there really is out there to sponsor these various things that we have going on to make the parks a more desirable place for people to be. So it's very encouraging to see from that end. One highlight, you know, with Menominee Park Zoo, you know, we continue to work towards the Eagle exhibit and develop funds for doing that. With the updated costs, I think I highlighted this last meeting, that the updated costs in steel and construction to when the original plan for that facility was designed in 2016. We're looking at a significant increase of close to $90,000 above and beyond here going forward. So that's one of these projects we continue to go forward to search funding for, to see if we can have this enhanced exhibit come into the zoo in the future, and hopefully it will be as things progress here through the budget process and other things coming up here. Last year, with the major improvements where Ray highlighted the Sea Sand and Sailorland Playground, we also had the Fugelberg Park Playground that was replaced with accessible routes and poured-in-place surfacing. Big enhancements continue with our progression with the playground development in the parks throughout the community. Some other areas that we worked upon in Tech Miller Park, you know, the new park lighting that's out there, the athletic field renovation design, which currently we are doing the renovation of the field right now where the new infield is in at phase one of grading. Hopefully some fencing and all that stuff will go up here within the next week, or the backstop. We have some concrete work to do and then finish off that field too going into the end of the month. So looking forward to see that take place. The restroom renovation for ADA compliance, security features with the doors for you know, lockable devices, so we don't have to go up and tend to those in the evening hours. Been a big enhancement to a lot of our areas throughout the parks itself. Had some major collaborating with the building services division. We had roof replacements, you know, at the train station, Menominee Park, Fugelberg Boat Launch Restroom, Reitz Concession Stand, Spanbauer Concession, and we have a restroom building and a small service shed there that was taken as well. Menominee Park Zoo, again, the Eagle exhibit for fundraising, the site preparation where some has taken place over there, the Otter exhibit where we did the sidewalk perimeter, completed that last year, landscape, and then just maintenance buildings improvements, which we're continuing with as we speak for future developments of interior educational animal exhibit areas, hopefully going into 2019. The Riverwalk enhancements with the historical signs and benches installations around there, and also currently we just finished up the Morgan District area with the benches, as Ray mentioned, the lake fly, and there's going to be some signage eventually coming through there too. The Leach Amphitheater, the doors and frames painted, it's just some of those things where you get past the 5-10 year mark of the facility already, that things that we got to enhance, take care of with painting. Built a concession wall in the concession stand to help divert some of the exhaust traffic in there. Signboards for the concession stands. Jenny and I got a plan to look forward to some enhancements to the Leach going forward, hopefully in 2019, if things go well through the budget process and a goal of ours. The boat launch areas continue to improve with the kiosks at multiple locations. We're going to be bringing in automatic pay stations at 24th Street and Fugelberg and Steiger and Fugelberg Park here, hopefully in the next year, and open up that next spring. Plus with Fugelberg Park, the playground or the restroom renovation is going very well right now. And in the fall, we're going to look into the south ramp extensions to see if that can be put in at that site as well at some time here in the near future. Some maintenance items at the community water park regarding the ceiling to the front entrance that we ended up, it used to be an artistic type mural that was up on the ceiling that was just challenging to maintain, and due to safety concerns, having people come in and do that type of work. So we decided to put aluminum soffit over the top of that and reduce some of our maintenance stuff there. And Mary Jewel shelter construction began, which is nearing completion as we speak right now, going forward. And there's a couple items that I noticed from the senior center that our staff was intricate in helping with or cooperating with everyone on is the design of the fitness area and how we help construct the walls in there, develop some new workstations in there for both the staff, the fitness staff, and also Jenny's office that moved from the Menominee Park area over there for a better working environment going forward. So. And then also to highlight the Riverside Park ice rink. We know we got some work to do down there on the site to get ready for this year to make that a better environment for the filling point of that rink. But hopefully things will come together here in the fall, and that'll be another great partnership that we worked with the Community Foundation having that, rink installed last year. So it's neat to see all the things happen. Also to how they correlate to things that are already occurring in the current year. And I guess as we get into the budget process and what we're working towards next year to bring back to show you guys and what you've already kind of prioritized in our CIP projects, it's neat to see everybody involved going forward. So
I'll finish off a couple items quickly, but Kathy Snell, who's our special events coordinator for the city, works for our department as well. So you'll see some information on page 14 regarding the special events. Just to highlight a couple items, there were 120 events that were approved by the Common Council in 2017. And you'll see below on some of the comments, 91% to 98% are satisfied with the process as well as locations and the event personnel helping with the process. Ann is our marketing and fund developer, again, who helped put this together. And Ann was successful this year in receiving a $45,000 grant from the DNR to assist with the Riverwalk refurbishment behind the Leach Amphitheater that I talked about earlier, as well as a number of donations and sponsorships for the Senior Center. She does a lot of work for getting donations and sponsorships there to purchase new fitness equipment, as well as helping the Friends, which we touched on a little bit as well in this document. And then the last item on the bottom of page 15, we've really really gone out into social media world a little bit more with Ann, and you can take a look at some of the information. Facebook fans of all of our pages have increased over 67% since 2016. Total number of likes on pages has reached over 15,000. So I think, as Chad said, there's just so much going on, and this is just a list of some of the special projects. Then you have the day-to-day operations of ball field maintenance and lawn mowing and tree trimming and everything else that all the staff are involved with. And, it's not just sitting at this table, but it's all the guys and ladies out in the field that really make sure that the parks are looking good for the citizens. So if there's any questions at all, feel free to ask us. And
I just wanted to say, I'm not on Facebook, so I don't have any likes on there, but I wanted to say thank you, and that the staff is doing a really good job. And it's very clear from this report, I know the Parks Board already knows this stuff, but it seems like there's a lot of momentum going for the parks, and it's really impressive what you're doing. So I just want to say keep up the good work. It's going awesome.
Thank you.
All right, any other business?
I'll make a motion.
I'll second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. You can do it.